Okay, I just saw you playing all day and you look real good. Who are you?
Well, you know, I'm Yuka Kisa. I'm the best footballer pointed at the season.
Oh, really? You know any of the older players who play here?
Well, I know Warren Archibald, Leroy Dillion.
Stop. You know me? Boy, I was the best striker, the best forward that this country ever seen.
Oh, Wilfred K.
Boy, I'm Steve David, boy. Okay, welcome viewers. It's another edition of Field of Dreams on Axe Television Network. My name is Steve David and I'm your host. This is a station we talk football and football only every Monday night. And we're gonna talk football, we're gonna talk college football since the college league just started. And with me, I've got a couple of the older college players that's been through the system. Not very old, but they've been through the system and they will give us some insight on college football. Let me take time to introduce Anthony Sherwood. And Anthony, you represented Presentation College.
Presentation College, yes.
And what can you tell the viewers a little bit about your time, probably been a short introduction?
I think I started Presentation College in the 80s. It was, you know, amazing time for players who aspire to play in college's league football because of the magnitude of the game itself at that level. I spent about 4 years at Presentation, won a national championship, had the good fortune of doing that, and then left at the end of sixth form, to go to the United States on a scholarship.
Okay, excellent. And also with us, my good friend Leonson Lewis. And Leonson, you went to Naparima, right?
Right.
Say hi to the viewers.
Yes, yeah? Good night to all your viewers. First, I actually passed, at that time was common entrance for St. Benedict's College. So at that time, St. Benedict's College didn't really play I can't remember the name of it, but it was like a championship league and then it was the senior league. So at that time, I remember actually being in St. Benedict's College and going to Skinner Park to watch players like Rattan and Demin, Kun Das, the William brothers now, one is a cricket coach for the national team, the DPP, who's now Roger Gasper as well, played for NAP. So I remember in Benedict's sitting down and watching these players play and saying, yes, this is what I want to do. This, I have to get to Naparima College because the football there was like phenomenal. It was really, really big. It wasn't like how it is now. But when we go and we look at a game in Skinner Park, it was like the whole Skinner Park was like full. People on the cycle track. So it was really, really something out of this world to even get to play at that level.
Okay, great. I want to welcome you guys to Field of Dreams.
Thanks, Steve. Thanks for having me.
Welcome. And we're going to talk about, again, college football, and we're going to talk about all the good old days. And let's start with the structure of the college's football league. I know in our time, it was a little bit different than now. What did the structure look like in your time?
Well, I think it's changed quite a bit. And I always heard about college's league football when you were, you know, Steve, obviously part of St. Benedict's with guys like Leroy DeLeon and so forth. in my time, I mean, the league was structured in such a way that all of the teams, for instance, in South, in the championship division, would play each other. And then the top team at the end of two rounds, home and away, would essentially enter what's referred to as a Big Seven. And the Big Seven was used to crown the national champions. And then, of course, once that was finished, then you'd now get into the Inter-Cul series, which again was the same thing. You know, you played throughout the South Division, and then, you know, the top four teams in the country would meet in the national semifinal, and then obviously the national final.
It's like two leagues then?
Yes.
It's like playing in one league and then
exactly
qualifying to go and play
exactly
in another.
So the only time you really had a chance in my era to encounter teams like St. Mary's or Fatima or Arima or St. Augustine was as a result of you know, doing well, obviously, being the top team in South. And then that sort of an opportunity would arise. So that was really the incentive for us based on that format.
It's about a little different with you guys, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. And I remember talking to Ken Fulong. He played with St. Mary's or one of those other teams. He was telling me then that in his time, the colleges league were allowed to play like in the professional league, like in the normal league, where it have like Malvern and these big teams. So they as college players used to play at 15, 16 year old.
Top
they
level.
Used to play at the top level. They playing against all the Malvern and the big teams. And so once your team was the first two, three teams in the college league was allowed to play big football. And then the other teams could play by themselves. It was a little different in my time. My time was more like how it was now, because I remember playing against most of the top schools when I did transfer and go to Naprima College. It was more like now. I remember playing against all the other big teams: St. Augustine, QROC, Fatima, Mukurapu. All these teams made up one pro league, one big league, and the championship league, and all the teams played against each other. And then, of course, you win the league like that. And then, of course, it had the Inter-Cul league where you're playing South first. And then you go to the professional. I think with NAPS, we reached the semifinal. We reached the final, but we never won it at that time. But NAPS, of course, won a lot of times then.
So the league is obviously different in a sense, because it's been changing. What do you think about the league now, the way it's set up? What do you guys think?
I think it's a great format because the truth of the matter is that, for instance, in my time, one of the things that we always lamented was the fact that it just didn't seem as if the teams that were based in South were getting the kind of recognition or the respect, if you will, you know. And it was unfortunate that you had to win the entire South Zone and win Inter-Cul in South to get an opportunity to test yourself against the so-called bigger teams and maybe in the North or in the East. So that was a massive incentive for us, to be honest with you. That's one of the reasons we wanted to win the league. So the fact that I think with this new format, right off the bat, you're getting an opportunity, for instance, to see a game between Naprima College and Sawa. You know, that to me is a very, very positive development. No question about it.
And, you know, in our time, they only had 6 teams, really, 3 in the North and 3 in the South.
Right.
Now they got about 20-something teams.
Yeah, a lot of teams. A lot of teams now.
Right. So, and your time was what? Was about 10 teams, maybe 12 teams?
10 or maybe
so?
12 teams.
Right. Yeah. So what do you favor? The structure they have now or what
I
you played in?
I think definitely the structure now, like what I played in, is definitely the better way, because there you get top class players. And remember, if you do, I think this league has a promotion and a demotion as well.
Yes.
Yes.
Right. Yes.
So that is how football is supposed to be on the whole. So once you see you don't make, I think the last two teams goes down to another division, and then the best two teams come up. So it keeps the competition more alive and more spectacular with the better teams playing against each other and the better teams wanting to play in that league.
That might encourage or feel unjust activity between the coaches and the principals to try to get the best players.
Well, that happens anyway.
Yeah.
That happens anyway, no matter what league.
Yeah?
That's been happening forever, Steve, to be honest with you. I mean, as long as I have known the, you know, college football, There's always been the movement of players, you
and
know.
And now probably a little worse.
Yeah.
Because everybody wants to play, even the players, eh? Because
the players team, themselves, yeah.
For example, when I used to play at St. Mary's College and they were not in the championship league, all I wanted to do was to play at that level. So it's the same thing with the players now. If their school, for example, not playing at that championship level, right. they're going to want to move. And of course, the teams that are there will want to stay there. So they're going to want to get the best players.
Yeah.
Now, the problem for the school and the kids now is to balance the academics with the football.
Right.
And I think once you talk to various coaches within the league, one of the things that concerns them is the massive movement of players in some cases. There are one or two teams in the north, for instance, that have become well known for the influx of players, if you want to call it, 2 weeks before school actually opens and prior to the beginning of the league itself, you know. But I think it's just part and parcel of colleges league football. The concern for me as somebody who's looking at it from the outside is what's happening to those guys, you know, the kids who are actually being lured into these schools, you know. Are their needs really being addressed academically, their development as kids? Hopefully they're not being exploited is what I'm saying.
Exactly.
You know, that is always, you know, at the end of the day, that is the thing that I tend to pay a little bit of attention to.
Well, I mean, the parents should monitor that and kind of.
Well, it's hard though, you know. Let's say, for instance, a school like St. Mary's College or Fatima has reached out to a young man going to maybe. I certainly don't want to disrespect any of these schools, but a smaller school.
Right.
And the principal of one of these schools approaches the parent of one of these kids, it's hard to say no, because, you know, you're talking about schools that have a degree of prestige and you know.
Oh, I agree. I would send my kid to that school. But,
right.
I mean, you're saying, how are they going to take advantage of that situation? Because you're giving them a chance for a good education.
All right, so, and I could speak to this because, I mean, I experienced this to some extent. You know, you're taking a kid, for instance, who is leaving not a prestige school, if you will. And like I said, my big thing is that I do not want to disrespect any of these schools. And you take that child from one of those schools who is pursuing maybe at the form five or form four level, four or five subjects, and you transfer that student now into a school where he's being asked to do 9 or 10 subjects. Right off the bat, you're dealing with a student athlete, because that's what they are. They're student athletes who is incapable of coping academically, you know, because you're just not prepared to make that sort of a jump academically speaking.
No, but wait. If you into a smaller school,
yes,
why you have to do 5 subjects? Why can't you do 10? That is a kid choice, I think, at that point.
I don't know what the curriculum is
not
like.
Not really, Steve, because the kid that goes to college, and for example, from the kid that goes to a junior sec, because we had half kids leave a junior sec and go to a college. The thing is, when they are the junior sec, they are more at a comfort level, and even the level, for example, a form 2 junior sec kid going to a form 2 Naprima College or Presentation College.
Massive difference.
It's a massive difference.
I understand the level.
And sometimes the kid capability of coping with that work is
almost impossible.
It's almost impossible. Yeah. It's two different things.
You have kids, for instance. So I'll give you an example, Steve. I'll give you an example. in maybe a junior sec, for instance, that student is maybe doing one foreign language, Spanish. All right. He goes into a school like Naparima or Presentation or what have you. And all of a sudden now, in addition to Spanish, he's also having to do French, for instance, having missed almost 3 years of doing French. So right off the bat, when you're in the term exams, for instance, when everything is said and done, that child is going to end up inevitably at the bottom of the class. I don't know if that makes sense to you.
But
yeah.
Steve, but
they don't have junior sec no more. One.
Well, they're just changing names.
They're just changing names.
That's really what they've done.
You have to realize that in Trinidad, some of these kids that goes to those schools, two things they can do. They can play football.
Right.
Is one. Studying is not really their real...
Their strength.
Their strength. So we have had kids, I know of kids that left schools and go to other schools, and what they do in the school, they just walk around the school, yeah. They're hardly in class.
And that we need to change.
Exactly. And the schools are okay with it, because at the end of the day, for instance, we're going into the Colleges League season. Schools football, Colleges League football, brings an amazing amount of positive attention to all of these schools.
Exactly.
You know? So the schools benefit certainly from that attention and that positive feedback or what have you. But therein, or in the midst of all of that, is a young individual, a young man who is now struggling immensely. So yes, he's very good at the football and does well for that school. But once the game's finished, you know, you have to now become very, very concerned with what's happening with that student athlete.
And Anthony,
once the season's finished.
And not only that, once the season's finished, some of these kids don't even stay in school.
Exactly.
That's even another part of
it. So that's a total other issue, other than saying, well,
exactly.
A big school is going to take advantage of him, because a big school is giving him an opportunity to change his life. That's how I look at it.
Yeah, but the school also has a responsibility the school also has a responsibility, because I remember when I was at Naparima College, there's no way I wasn't going to play until I had my homework done, until I had a certain level.
Right. Exactly.
The teachers at that time made sure that these kids that missing the work or that less in class because of whatever, that they are up to standard, and that does not go on now.
Yeah. Okay, at the end of the program, I'll give you guys a chance to talk to those kids and tell them what you think and what they need to do. All right, so right now, let's talk about football rivalry. Who was you guys? I know you guys were great players in your time. I heard about you, and I was playing professional football outside. But I know there's other players that was in your team and your team, and who lift your game, or opposition who made you play better? Who were those players?
Well, I mean, it's interesting, because I mean, Leonson is a guy that I saw playing at Naparima College.
Right.
I remember coming, he mentioned playing in Skinner Park. So he was a guy that I looked at as somebody who was just very, very different. You know, his skill set, what he brought in terms of entertainment value was something that you know, it was just really inspiring to me per se. But throughout the Colleges League in my time, I mean, you had a guy like Dwight York, who was playing at Signal Hill.
Oh, he was in your time?
Yes.
Right,
he
was in your
time. So he, you know, I think the Colleges League is actually the opportunity that was presented to him to really bring himself to prominence. That's when Signal Hill went on to have the success under Bertil Sinclair that they did. That's when people really took notice of Dwight York. And in addition to Dwight York on that team, you had a guy like Colvin Hutchinson that we all know very well. In the days of San Fernando Technical Institute, well, that was a different story altogether, because you had Russell Latapy,
Marvin Faustin.
You had
Andrew
a national team, essentially.
Yeah.
So there were a lot of guys. I mean, there were a lot of guys that as a youngster coming up.
What about you?
Yeah, definitely, because...
Who were the players that...
They had a lot of, they had so much players. I remember seeing Gad Polonier.
Iverson was it in your time?
Iverson.
Samson.
This is...
Gwent Benedict or...
Nigel Neverson?
It's Samson. He's trying to...
Ivan Samson was definitely...
That was more your time.
That was my time. So Ivan Samson was probably...
One of the better ones.
Would have been my biggest rival in South football.
Right.
It ultimately always came down to Ivan Sampson representing St. Benedict's College.
Right.
And to some extent, you know, I was there with a few other players, of course. I think we always had a more balanced team, you know, representing, you know, presentation. So those games were like, you know, a war of sorts, you know, both on the field and between the supporters of those two schools.
Yeah, and I think too, Anthony, for some reason, it seemed that back then, like in my time, it just had more talented players. You know, no college team, because I coach a college team. I coached NAPS for a couple of years, and I had to use under 16 players. I think they end up winning the league 2 or 3 years after. That's with Jabari Mitchell and Watson and Das. They end up winning, but they were actually playing senior football at 16 years old. You know, because the talent is so difficult, and I got those players from since W Connection had an under 13 pro project, and we went to Point 14, so we got these players, put them in the pro league, and some of them actually went to the school. But what I was saying back then, for example, when I heard about your time with Steve David, and when you talk about him with Jan Steadman, Warren Archibald, Dillion, for example, the Benedicts of Pass was like a national team. I think they actually beat the national team and they played against the Army. That cannot be done now because the amount of players. I went to see an Aparima College game and I remember seeing Kuhn Das. So much different. Diaz, there was Vidal, there was Demin, there were Rat. Everybody was a talent on the team. So as it started to go lower, the talent just becoming less and less and less. Now, there's still talented players. Of course, you talk about Levi Garcia.
Right.
There's a lot of talented players still. But just the amount of players that we would have played, we would have seen play.
Right.
And we would have played with and played against. In our time, it just seems like the talent of way back from the 80s to now is totally different. Now you can actually pick out players. You have to pick out players and you have to build a team around
one or
certain
two players.
And that time you have a team, you have a team. Even when I time it had, everybody could have hold their own. You know, when you watch at your defenders, you watch at your midfielders. I remember Dexter Lopez I played with. Right. Rest in peace, Dexter Lopez. But was a phenomenal player. You know, we were always fighting who were number 10 and who were number 11 because he was that good.
Right.
And we had other players that, to me, the talent level of the player, the people back in the 80s, I don't know if it's because of the video games or the phone or they have less distraction. The talent of those players back then was so much more than players now.
Yeah.
I always tell people on a national team, a coach never showed me how to play a position. It was a natural thing. You never have to tell a left wing when to come in to score a goal. And now you have to teach kids every single aspect of the game.
You guys heard him. Lots more to come. When we come back, we get into Intercult Fever. We'll be right back after a short break.
Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited offers solutions to your immediate and future potential problem areas. By providing you with a qualified team of safety consultants, Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited, building a reputation on quality and value since 1999. Located 23 Todd Street, San Fernando, Trinidad. Phone 868-657-1534 or 868-788-6955. WorldwideSafety@yahoo.com.
Okay, welcome back, viewers. You tuned into Field of Dreams on Axe Television Network. Before the break, we were discussing all the great players that came through college football. Now I want to switch gear to Intercult Fever, what it was like. In our time, anytime is October, and you hear the radio once a year in October, Federal Green Savannah, that's all about Intercult.
Yeah.
What happened in you guys' time? And tell me some of you guys, Intercult Fever, jitters, or whatever you had.
Well, Intercult was always, it's a total different ball game to, say, the league. When it's Intercult, for some reason, every team feels that no matter what we did during the league, we're going to win the Intercult.
Right.
It's always have an extra.
It was almost like the league prepared you.
Yeah, for the Intercult.
Yeah, for the Intercult tournament. You
exactly.
know, it's like we're going to use the league and the amount of games that we have to play to get us to the point where we're peaking when the Intercol, you know, series began.
Exactly, and some of the players and some even the supporters in the school, they weren't really listening too much of the result when the league, nobody goes to see the league, the stands are almost never full.
Right. Intercol,
but only the diehard, but for Intercol, for some reason,
yeah.
every single person comes to the game, and for Intercol is the time that you have to shine. No matter what, I remember our Intercol game against, can't remember which team it was, and I was really sick that day. I mean, I was struggling, I couldn't do anything. And I played, I think, half of the game. And I was walking off the ice, I tell the coach, I can't go back home because I just not feeling myself. I was really, really sick. And my dad come out of the stand and he was so upset with me. I said, Dad, I'm not feeling well. He said, Leonson, this is intercall. You cannot come off the field. I can't remember what happened to the game. But I mean, he was so upset with me that because it's really a once in a lifetime.
Yes.
It's a once in a lifetime thing. And I mean, the crowds and it's just an amazing, amazing.
Even around school, everything is buzzing, right?
Oh, yeah.
Everything is buzzing around the school. And
the atmosphere around that time was just
playing music in the
unbelievable. And it almost, even within these schools, you know, the rhythm sections would be the gearing practice. Themselves up for when intercall came around, you know. So everybody was fine tuning the, you know, the songs and the chants. Every school had their own little chants, for instance.
Tell me some of your chants.
I don't, to be honest with you,
No Sadana Hill can beat a Sadana Flat. You ever hear that one?
No Sadana Hill can beat a Sadana Flat.
If you think we're lying, ask Naparim about that, but that used to just aggravate me on the field. Presentation used to be over and over.
Yeah. So presentation used to beat you then?
Not really. It was very even
at one
time.
I mean, all these teams have gone through spells, you know?
So give me a... I just heard one of Nap's chats.
Steve, I would not be allowed to repeat some of these stuff maybe that's chanted at some of the games. Not that it was ridiculously obscene or anything, but it was just, the idea really is that, you know, the fans wanted to take that opportunity to stick it to the, you know, to the opposing fans and players.
Yeah, and it goes on even now.
I think it's part and parcel of the tradition of intercall, to be honest, you know. So the rhythm section, I mean, I remember, you know, most of these schools have bands, you know, that are utilized for various activities or events. And the bands themselves were the ones having practice sessions, you know, to get things coordinated. The flags, the banners, I mean,
just the
trip from, for instance, from Presentation College down to Skinner Park was an event in itself, you know.
And you talk about when you score a goal, what happens
when
a goal score?
Yeah.
Players. The students running on the field, people taking off their shirt is total madness.
You know, like Leo, I mean, obviously Leonson has been involved in football as far as Trinidad and with his club in Europe, football at the highest level, you know. And I have had the good fortune myself to play, you know, games for Trinidad and Tobago that I recall fondly. But some of my best moments, or some of the most vivid moments that I can recall in football, were those moments that in an intercall final, scoring, you know, the go-ahead goal, and just seeing the reaction essentially of all of the supporters. I mean, it you know, and at you know, at college league, you're young guys, you're like 15, maybe 16 years old.
Tell me your most memorable.
I mean, there were a lot of them. I think beating St. Mary's College in a national intercall semi-final in the stadium was memorable for me because Shaka Hislop was in goal.
Oh yeah,
St. Mary's was considered to be the top team. We felt in South that we weren't getting any respect. We hadn't lost a game, to be honest with you. But the television station seemed to be focusing on everything that's happening in Port of Spain. So we almost went into that game with something of a chip on our shoulders, you know, and I think CIC was probably favored. And we went into that game and won, I think, 4-1, if I'm not mistaken. And it wasn't even so much about Prez beating CIC. It was about South has destroyed this mecca of a team from the North with again, a guy like Shaka Hislop and company. So
what was the final score?
The final score, I think, was 4-1, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
A gentleman named Colin Osborne, who was the son of the late Carlos Bond. Phenomenal player.
Very
strong,
fast.
Powerful.
Very fast.
Had a hat-trick that day, you know, and I actually scored my first goal at the season. So it meant so much to me that was the first time I went into a game all season. Right. I was playing like a deep-lying center midfielder. But I said, if there's one game that I have to somehow or the other find myself close enough to goal to have a chance to get one in the back of the net, it was that particular game.
What would you know?
Yeah, I had some nice memories both at Naparima College too. I remember one of my favorite games of all time would be when Naparima College played the great San Fernando Tech.
Yes.
San Fernando Tech had Latipi, Faustin. they had like 9 or 10 national players. Andrew Ali was in goal.
Right.
They had you name them. Even their second team was like a first team, and all Naparima College had was a couple players.
Right.
Leonson Lewis, Dexter Lopez.
And I think I saw that game. I remember being in Skinner Park and watching that game.
And everybody know that San Fernando Tech had to represent Napurima College in that game.
Right.
That game, we won. I can't remember if I scored. I can't remember who scored. But I remember we won that game 1-0.
Right.
And it was like, for Napurima College, it was like madness.
Amazing.
Because it has no way that this Napurima College could beat this national team with all these players. So that was definitely one. We end up losing to St. Augustine. Sean Ligier was really, really good at that.
Right.
I think he scored a bicycle in that game or something.
Yes.
So Sean Ligier was for the Green Machine. They actually won the Intercol final.
And you know, what's funny about that is that if you ask Napurima supporters about that particular year, they probably recall more vividly that victory that you all had against San Fernando Technical Institute opposed to like the final. It's interesting.
I remember the other year I went to San Fernando Tech after that. Well, that's to compete the national team. They brought me to San Fernando Tech. And I think we won everything. We won the national. Of course, we won the Intercol final. We won every single game. And the only game we drew was a game with against St. Mary's. I think that Shaq Hester saved. You should see that St. Mary's team when that game drew. You think they won an Intercol final. The only game. So those two memories for me were really, really something. You know, playing for Napurima College and playing for...
I think it was all about the occasion, Steve.
I
couldn't imagine what it would have been like when you were at St. Benedict's, to be honest with you. Because they talk about, you know, in our time we recall, you know, San Fernando Technical Institute, maybe John D to an extent. And that represented like a massive team at the Colleges League level. But I couldn't even imagine what it would have been like.
We know nothing of the Benedicts, but the Jan Stedman, the Leroy Dillion, the Steve Archibald.
Yeah.
We know nothing.
That's another show.
That's another show.
But listen.
But we need, Steve, I'm telling
you,
we need to know about those things because, and I think that's one of the things that's been lost on us, the sense of history. I grew up with that history because my father and my mom would constantly remind me about these guys, you know.
Exactly.
I just lived knowing that one day, you know, as a midfielder, you would want to even have just the opportunity to see like a Leroy Dillion play, you know, as forward Steve David play. So it's those things are things that we have to keep those memories very much alive.
No, we are, it's just part of another
Archibald
show. We do have a
me.
Show.
The first time I ever met Archibald was in Germany. So he walked up to me and they told me that this is Archibald. And I was like, Archibald. So I shook his hand, expecting some big to see this short guy came up to me. And he said, so you don't remember me? I said, no, I don't even know you. He said, well, let me tell you something. You were at Skinner Park at 3 years old. And you were passing the ball. He said, you didn't even know that. So so I was like 3 years and he was playing passing.
He and your dad had a lot of memorable moments. That's why you show
you. Oh, yeah. I heard about those.
But isn't it funny how I said, give me some of you guys' memorable moments, and everything is on when you won. How about when you lost?
Oh, yeah.
You guys can remember?
Definitely. I had the misfortune of losing in a national Intercol final.
Yeah.
And I think one of the reasons for that, quite frankly, is that we were so hyped to play St. Mary's College. We felt that a victory against CIC in that particular series would have ensured a victory in the final. Mm-hmm. And we absolutely overlooked, I think it was El Dorado at the time, which had a very, very good team, to be honest with you. But we weren't even really concerned about it. And it was losing in that final was the very first loss of the entire season for us. And it was just something, I mean, it was just left dumbfounded, to be honest with you, you know? So it definitely stuck out for me, losing an Intercol final the way we did. I remember the disappointment on the fans, the faces of the fans. I mean, it was just that ride down to South was just, there was like a deafening silence, you know. It very, very disappointing. But as I look back on it, I mean, those things are fond memories because in going forward and hoping to have success in whatever you're doing, it's great to have that success. But being able to deal with failures, you know, is almost equally as important in terms of an experience.
Yeah, definitely. For me, against St. Augustine as well.
Yeah.
I mean, Naps knew that to play against St. Augustine was like we were out of our zone because we just barely scraped through San Fernando Tech with all the stars.
Yeah.
So this was in the National Stadium, you know. But I mean, it hurt nevertheless.
Yeah.
It still hurt nevertheless. But for a failure, it was a good failure for us. even reaching to the final, you know. Right. So that to me was one of the failures that was.
But the good thing for us though is that after the Intercol was finished, there was now what was referred to as the Big Seven tournament or the Big Five, I think. So that was then the opportunity to sort of to focus now on the national championship, if you will. So in that particular year, I mean, it was great because we actually won a national championship, and the team that we beat in Union Hall, which was Prez's home venue at the time, was El Dorado. The gentleman, or one of the gentlemen who was associated with that team heavily, was a gentleman named Eddie Hart. And you know, you should have seen Eddie Hart on that particular day. It was that would have been the ultimate double for El Dorado at that time, you know, which is always a massive achievement at the colleges league level. So it was good, you know, it was good that we had a chance to sort of avenge what was a massive, massive loss. But it still felt like a letdown, to be honest. You know, everybody remembers the loss in the Intercol final as opposed to the win per se in the Big Five or the Big Seven final, you know, or tournament.
And after a loss, the toughest thing for me after a loss is going to school the next day to face all these students.
Oh, yeah.
But you guys hardly lost. You guys hardly lost.
Well, we hardly lost.
What about Nas? Like, you lose a lot.
Like you know.
You beat them next year, remember that?
Yeah.
It was always the thing with Nas. You get them next year.
It's funny you mentioned that, Steve, because that in itself was a little test of character at that age. Mm-hmm.
Well, especially when you didn't want to go to school.
Yeah, especially when you felt like you contributed to that loss. I lost this in Benix in a South final. Again, a team that had we gotten past that hurdle, we would have probably been favored to win the Intercol. And the game went down to penalty kicks. And throughout the entire season, I mean, somehow or the other, we were just getting by. And I myself was having a very good season. Stepped up to take a penalty and missed that penalty. And we lost that final. And I remember telling my mom the next day, I do not think I can show my face in school the next day, or for a while, to be honest with you. And it took everything in me to actually go into school that very next day and deal with the disappointment. And, you know, so it was a lot of character building, you know, a lot of character building, for sure.
I think our era were a little more disappointed with the football. And I see kids nowadays lose. And it's like,
it's not a big deal.
I remember at under 14 level playing against, I think it was Benedix against Prez. Anthony Clark was the goalkeeper.
Right.
And I kicked a penalty.
Right.
The ball really muddy.
Right.
Passed over the line. Anthony always reminded me of this. So he pulled it back over the line. And I was begging. I said, Anthony, tell them that goal score. And I was crying on the field. And he always laughed at that. And he always tell me. I think we were a little more passionate in the football at that time.
But I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that Colleges League was this massive, massive format of football in Trinidad. It was the first opportunity you had under normal circumstances to really showcase who you were as a footballer. Mm-hmm. And usually for most guys, that would either lead to national team selection or you just finish your career as a schoolboy, you know.
So Anthony didn't...
of course not. He was playing for prayers.
Yeah. Anthony, Anthony, I'm disappointed in you, buddy. He did you that. So you are...
And very
that
good
should
friends
have been a memorable thing for you.
Oh, yeah, that was real. That was and Anthony, and he punged me on that. From 14 years old, straight on, he'd always remember that.
And Anthony Clark was a big goalkeeper.
Big goalkeeper. He went on to be a national captain at under 16 level. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I see. At that, I mean,
there are a lot of stories about Anthony Clark. Even at Presentation, he never played for Presentation College at the championship level. You know, he made this massive stand within the school.
That.
Yeah, he was one of these guys. You know, he commanded such a presence, and it was one of the first times you ever had a player who said, "Listen, although I am the national goalkeeper at the under 16 or under 18 level or whatever it was, I am not playing for Presentation College." And it was a big, big
deal,
you know?
Let me tell you something else about Anthony Clark. Anthony Clark is the only, I remember when he was captain of the under 16 team.
Right.
He was the only man stand up to Jack Warner face to face And tell him whatever you have to tell him.
Yeah.
At 16 years old, Anthony Clark had a personality.
I didn't know that. Yeah. Interesting.
Stand up to Jack Warner and talk to him just like anybody else. And tell him so, and talking to him. Like if he was Anthony Clark, he always had a real personality. Yeah. I mean, up to this day.
That's my boy. I should have got him on the show.
He's been very, very busy.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, in the last 2 or 3 days, I know he's been very busy.
But I didn't know he played in your era.
Yeah.
Anthony was
a lot of. That's what I'm saying, Steve. There was just so the colleges really gave you such an opportunity to come to terms with who the really talented guys were in this country.
But it was
so I didn't play anybody unless we got to like a big seven or whatever from the East under normal circumstances. But I knew about Timothy Haynes and Kerry Jameson and all these guys because we were playing. You're following the exploits of the teams, you know, in the East or in the North or wherever, you know.
Dexter Sandy.
So it gave so many great players, so many players of tremendous potential, the opportunity to come to the forefront. And I'll be honest with you, that is what Colleges League in some ways represented to me. Gave me a chance to say, listen, you may not know who I am based on where I'm coming from. But you're gonna know about me at the end of this Colleges League.
One of the greatest players I ever played with, and I will always say this, was Gerard Vidal.
Yes.
Gerard Vidal kicked that ball like somebody from the 60s.
Right.
It's the first time I ever saw a ball froze. You used to call it the freeze. When Jerry kicks the ball, it never turns or goes. It just stays like this and shoots.
Wow.
I scored most goals because of Gerard Vidal. Because when he shoots at the goal, there's no goalkeeper alive could actually block or save that ball at one touch.
Yeah.
So as he shoots, I just follow up and had the easy tap.
Gerard
Vidal was phenomenal. I mean, really, really talented players in that era.
Yeah.
Tons of players that you can't even remember to call.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, let's take a break here at this point. When we come back, we will talk about some superstition. Let me find out if you guys had any superstition before or after a game. We'll be right back.
Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited offers solutions to your immediate and future potential problem areas by providing you with a qualified team of safety consultants. Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited, building a reputation on quality and value since 1999. Located 23 Todd Street, San Fernando, Trinidad. Phone 868-657-1534 or 868-788-6955. worldwidesafety@yahoo.com.
Okay, welcome back, viewers. You are tuned in to Field of Dreams on Axe Television Network. Again, we're talking college football. I've got two of the best in their time with me. And we promise you we'll talk to them about superstition in the game. What if they had any superstition before or after a game? So tell the viewers, what is your superstition?
The only superstition for me, I don't really think I had one. If I did, I can't remember. But I know every time I play, always have to see about my left foot first. If I put on my boots, so
that is superstition.
That is superstition. So it has to be. It was a natural thing to take off my bandages, take off my socks, and I had a special thing I used to do with. I used to have a pair of socks that I used to wrap around my ankle.
Right.
When you pull up your socks now, it just actually used to make your calves look bigger.
Right.
So everything had to be done on the left foot first, right. And then I will go on the right foot.
It was just useful for walking.
Every single game. Even when I went to the national team.
So what if you lose, after you've done that, you lose, you don't change it?
Oh, I don't even, it doesn't even matter. That was just.
That was your superstition.
That was just my thing to do.
You had
more like a habit.
I think the only thing I recall really was I was always the last person to walk out on my team. You know, maybe that was a statistical thing. Yeah, I don't know if that was a superstition per se or what have you, but. I just always remember being the last man walking out, you know, prior to the start of the game.
You wait to be the last person.
Yeah, it always happened that way, you know.
You were lucky.
For whatever reason.
I was always the last one. Steve, listen to this. I was always the last one to walk up because I had so much to do. Right. I always have so much to do. And you know, after I stopped playing football, I had nightmares that the national team playing and I'm trying to get on the field and I can't get on the field.
Yeah.
At times, least it boosts.
Is that right?
I used to have real serious nightmares and people calling me and I'm trying to put on my gears and for some reason,
yeah,
only a long time after I stopped playing football, that stopped. That
never
used to be
that.
Terrible dreams, you know.
But you're still like that a little bit today, right? Because when we go play these little practice games.
No, I always last. I always last. So much things to put on, I always last. So that's why, but even professional football as well.
Yeah.
I'm always the last one to come out the room.
Interesting.
So you guys know have nothing like you
wear
a suit.
I think what always scared me is if I didn't have a little chance prior to the games to have a little moment where, you know, you say a little prayer and you sort of collect yourself. Because in the midst of sometimes of these games, there's so much chaos that's going on. You know, you're in a dressing room. The dressing rooms are always very, very small. So it's almost as if you feel somewhat claustrophobic, you know. So for me, it was always important just to sort of, you know, hopefully have a little chance somewhere to just sort of, you know, just get yourself together, like I said, say a little prayer and then get yourself mentally ready to, you know,
so
to battle, essentially.
If that prayer didn't happen.
If it didn't happen, then it just didn't feel right.
Again?
Yeah, I don't know if, I think so, yeah. Yeah, I felt that sense of uneasiness, to be honest, you know.
Anthony, what about trying to score in one goal first?
Yeah.
You know, like,
yeah.
That was just the way it was sometimes
with some of the fields you played on. Because I remember playing in Skinner Park. If you were attacking a certain goal, there seemed to be a little bit of an advantage because you were going somewhat downhill as opposed to the other goal, for instance. You know?
Second half, you're more
so
tired,
winning the toss became critically important. You know, it could almost sometimes decide the outcome of a game. My last game, I'll never forget this. I remember when the captain of the team took the toss at that time. We lost the toss, and it meant that we were going
the opposite
direction we wanted to. And I just remember feeling the sense of anxiety, you know. Yes, we scored, we're one up, total euphoria, but I know St. Benedict's in the second half is going towards that goal as well, you know. So, yeah, little things like that, you know, definitely affected your psyche. I remember, again, we're young guys, you know.
Not in a position like Michael Jordan used to have a jersey. Under his jersey, it's called a jersey on. I never had nothing.
Is that right?
So,
okay.
Nothing like that. More
nothing
habit.
Like that.
Nothing like that. More habit.
And you had superstitions, I mean, yourself?
Of course. I mean, just like he says, I mean, I put on my left boot first. I put my right foot in my pants first. There's so many you have that. You don't do it, you're uncomfortable.
Yeah.
But it's not, I think it's habit more than superstition.
I think
but
so too.
Maybe
but
so,
you do
yeah,
it.
Maybe
anyway.
So.
If I do it the opposite, I would take it off and do it all over again.
Right.
You know?
You're real bad, see.
Interesting.
Yeah. Like OCD. You're real
or
bad.
You, I mean. it's everybody,
maybe it's
everybody
OCD
has
than superstition is what it sounds like, yeah.
Take it off. If I put on my pants and I think I put on, yeah, I'm taking it off.
Yeah. You have to start all over.
It's on.
Interesting.
Take
and I think sitting, for instance, in a certain seat, in the bus. Yeah, that was always like a big
that's
thing
another
for me,
thing.
You know? Always. If somebody was in that seat, I wasn't arrogant enough by any means to say, man, you have to get out that seat.
Right, yeah.
But I would just remember, you know, I'm not.
What about your jersey?
Yeah, what about this, you know? It was
what about your jersey number?
Yeah, that was a big deal in those
number
days
Number 11
as well.
To me,
yeah.
Up to this day, that number follows me.
That's
if
right.
I go, if
that's
I go
right.
in the cinema and I sit down and I look at the seat, number 11. If I go on anything, I go to travel on the bus, the woman
right.
on my ticket is number 11. It, wow. It's amazing.
That's
it's
good.
Yeah.
That number just follows me.
Interesting.
let's talk about some of the present college players now that you think has that potential to make an impact. Who that you know, because we have to motivate some of these guys, and
yeah.
I want to motivate some of these players to let them know that we're looking at them
for sure,
and we think they have the potential to do well. Who are those players?
Well,
I want to jump Anthony and say Levi Garcia.
Yeah.
Levi Garcia?
Yeah.
To me, Levi Garcia.
Oh, no question.
I had an opportunity to coach him when I was one of the coaches on the national team. And Levi Garcia has all the attributes it takes to be a professional player. Every single, he kicks with his 2 feet, he's strong, he's humble. he has a good touch. You know, it's very difficult.
He's not a guy that was saying was going outside to play to join some team.
Yes, he's actually signed to AZ Alkmaar in the Dutch first division. AZ Alkmaar finished behind PSV and I believe Ajax, so they are involved in Europa League football. But Levi, because he's 17, he's already signed that contract, but he's not able to start playing his football until November when he turns 18. So
is he in college now playing?
No, he's back in Trinidad. He's training.
Thinks with Marbella, actually.
Yes. Just essentially doing whatever he can to maintain a degree of fitness. We did a lot of work with him prior to him leaving for preseason. And then we're going to start back just sort of, you know.
Is he on the national?
He was on the under 17.
Yeah, he's been a national team player. You know, he represented Trinidad, I think, at 16 in the last U20 CONCACAF qualifying tournament for Trinidad. Outstanding player and a good example of a player. Who's made his name in the Colleges League with Shiva Boys, playing for coach Dexter Francis, for instance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for example.
But you've got
a lot of good talented players. Jabari Mitchell.
Jabari's out of school now, isn't he?
Yes. Isaiah Hudson. Is a great player as well, a great left-footed player as well. We have a lot of young players coming up. I like young Das as well.
Yes, yes. I've actually looked at Das quite a bit myself, you know, as far as like scholarships and so forth go. I think a lot of talented kids, you know, no question about it.
Okay.
But they're too many of them and they're too spread out, I think, a little bit.
Okay, I'll narrow it down a little bit, but I'll put you guys on the spot. Which is the best college team and who's going to win the Colleges League this year?
Not Prima College, off the bat.
Yeah. Sentimentally, I would want Presentation College.
Exactly.
But I think St. Anthony's College this year will be very, very good. Naparimo, obviously, is current champions. I know Angus very well.
Champions.
And yeah, they won the first incarnation of the new league, if you will, the college's Premier League. So they are defending champions going into this current season.
Didn't they win the Intercol as well? They won
No, lost the Intercol.
So
I think I think St. Anthony's College.
Always a big four.
Yeah. I think St. Anthony's College is.
Why would Naps win and why would St. Anthony's win?
For me, Naps will win because, number one, they started off with a team that was playing together since 13 years. As I told you, we brought that team they started from Connection, then they went to Naps. And they still have a good couple of players. I think the coach is doing very well as well. Angus Eve as a professional coach that coaches in the Pro League. So he definitely has an edge on the other coaches, being a super football player.
Yeah.
He's one of the players that impressed me along with Ronald Carrington and players like these. So they have a super good coach that is already in form. And they have a team that they haven't lost a lot of players. So they could kind of transition easy into this season. And I'm saying that they're going to win, but I think they have a very good chance.
And Angus is the coach?
And Angus Eve is still the coach.
Yes.
The first year?
Second year.
Second or third year.
Okay. And why is St. Anthony's going to win this championship?
Influx of players
I think they've been a perennial powerhouse in Colleges League football in recent times. And I think the fact that they didn't do very well last year will be the impetus for them having a very, very strong season this year. Nigel Grosvenor is very, very familiar with the Colleges League game. He, I think, is going to know unequivocally the deficiencies that he had last year. And I think we talk about his ability to attract really good players. I think he would know unequivocally the sort of players that he needs to have this year in order to go on and win the league.
Well, I would pick St. Benedict's College. Ask me why.
All right.
St. Benedict's
which is
it's actually the only team that ever beat Naparima College last year.
Yes. Intercol semi-final in the South Zone,
I think they beat them twice.
Yeah. I remember watching St. Benedict's beat Naparima in Manny Ramchand.
But that's my second school. So if Nap doesn't win, Benedict's going to win.
So I picked them because of the green and gold.
Of course.
Because they're my old school. And because this year they're going to play in Point Fortin, the home game.
Wow. Wow.
So
well, that's interesting, because I mean, one has to ask the question, why are they not playing in the Commons?
Huh?
Yeah, interesting.
I don't know, but I know they're playing in Point.
Yeah.
And Mike Oval is the home ground, so that's where they have to contend with St. Benedict. So they're going to be a full force to be reckoned with.
And Dexter Cyrus has done, I think, a wonderful job.
Oh yeah, last year I think he has done really, really well.
It's only right to acknowledge what he's done for that school.
Exactly.
Okay, so give me all your memories, and now I'd like you guys to sum it all up and talk to the kids, because give them a good schooling on what they need to do to continue the academics and play the football and be a rounded person instead of just being a footballer. I don't like when I hear players are just being footballers and they don't finish their education and all that, because there's a lot of life beyond football. So talk to them kids for me.
No, I just think the kids, I think apart from talking for the kids, the parents has to play a very important part in the decision that the kids make. I think nowadays kids make too much of a decision which school they want to go, you know, and which club they want to play for. I think the parents definitely have to play a better role or a stronger role in determining which part or how they play, you know, because football is easy, you know, you play at your school level, but there's life after football, you know, and it's not everybody could play, because I will always say, to play professional football, you have to be very lucky. You have to be talented, but you have to be very lucky, because it has a lot of talented people out there, and talent alone is not going to cut it to be a professional footballer. It's a certain mentality that comes with it. You have to know that this is what you want. You have to have no doubt, and you have to really, really strive to be a professional footballer. So you must have, even to be a football coach, these days takes subjects, and it takes studying, and it takes hard work. So I think the kids these days need to really, really focus. They need to balance it, because it has been done. It has been done before, and it could always be done. You have to put away your time and really balance yourself in terms of playing the football and in terms of studying. I think it's really, really important, because it's not easy to be a professional footballer, by no means.
Right.
I definitely want to echo what Leo said. I mean, I think parents as a whole have to play a bigger role. But I think the message I would want to convey to players, I mean, any Colleges League player, is that you must understand that your time at St. Mary's College, your time at Prez, at Naparima College, is limited, very, very limited. As long as you think, as much as of a career as you think you're going to have at these schools, the truth of the matter is that most Colleges League players may play maybe 3 years, maybe 4 years. So the big question you have to ask yourself is, what happens after? And if you're not positioning yourself properly, in other words, if you're not spending enough time ensuring that you're getting a minimum amount of subjects, that academic profile is critically important, then you're going to find yourself in the wilderness. You're going to find that you have less options available to you. And that is the worst thing to have happen to a young man at 17 or 16 years of age. To actually finish playing for these big schools in the Colleges League, and then the very next year, you have absolutely no real options and nothing to show for it. So do not allow yourself to be exploited or taken advantage of by schools that will benefit from your talent and your, you know, and everything you bring to these schools, without understanding that you must be able to have something to show for that experience.
Exactly. Well done.
Thank you, guys. I want to thank you guys for being here. I appreciate you guys so much. I really enjoyed this conversation with you. And I want to thank our viewers for allowing us into your homes and tuning us on every Monday night from 8 o'clock on Axe Television Network. I also want to thank Axe Television Network for giving us this opportunity. Viewers, don't forget, we have a Facebook page, and we also have an email address, fieldofdreamstt@gmail.com. Drop us a line, and we really appreciate you so much. We have come to the end of the show. So go in peace. We see you next Monday at 8 o'clock. And I'm Steve David, saying good night.